Welcome to the Startup Grind. Okay, I just want to ask everyone, does anyone know who Isa is already?
Or have a brief?
Because they know it's about restaurant. I just want to know, do you guys know his history, who he is, why he's so special? Neither do I. But no, I'm joking. No. He's a very good friend of mine. And what I call always on my Snapchat, I always call him the real foodie. Okay, I've never seen anyone eat, like try so many things. You don't eat a lot, but you try everything. And really have a passion for food as much as Isa does. I mean, all of us, when our salary comes in, the first thing, the majority is for rent. For him, it's food. And every time we travel together, I have to tell him, listen, hold back on the food, Choowy. Okay, I have kids. I can't afford it that much. Relax. And because he really has a passion for eating. So I first heard of you, and I think many people first heard of you, when it comes to Choowy Goowy,
yes,
which is the cookie concept. And one of the first, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, was one of the first small businesses, home businesses that started in Kuwait, if not the first. And I remember you achieved massive success. Can you tell us about Choowy Goowy, how it started?
First, it was never a home business. We started professionally, even with the tasting. We took the place in Hawali 2004, and we started in 2005 in September. Back then I was in university. We were ready in April in 2005, but we decided to start with intikhabat al-jam'a, our election. Back then we didn't have Instagram, we didn't have social media, we didn't have WhatsApp, we didn't even have BlackBerry. But it was really hard and how to get the word out. The most powerful tool was word of mouth. فكنا ننطر الإفكت in each week ننطر رياية معد بنات يا دوانية to know exactly إن did we do good ولا الناس تتكلم ولا لا. فأنا هذا الشيء اللي أنا مثلا أحسد عليه الناس الحين when they now with one post ولا one message you can reach millions of people that easy, everybody can know about you.
Absolutely.
عشان كذي دائما اقول if you can't succeed now متى راح تنجح if it's that easy. Yes, the competition is really hard. ف back then when we took the place بحولي we didn't have the capital at all. بس we knew that we can do it. يعني in any business there are three main elements that you need to have as a business perspective. Quality, presentation and service. In order for you to have the perfect product, forget if it's F&B or real estate or whatever. If it's service industry, those three crucial elements are the main factor of any business, which are to have the perfect quality, an amazing presentation, and efficiency in service. But in order to create those three elements in a product, from a business perspective, you have the customer perspective, which are the three main elements for the customer are the price, quality and service, and he can never have the three together. Never. If you want to go to a hotel, even if you have money or you don't have money, there are a certain amount of things that you respect or understand to pay. So if you went to a hotel, you will have an amazing food in a five-star restaurant. The service is going to be amazing, but the price is just going to be ridiculous.
So. Yeah.
And vice versa, you go to a very small place. You will have an amazing price, but the quality isn't that good and the service is really bad. So you can only choose two to give to the customer. What we did in the beginning that we want to have three of them when we started to. We wanted to have the best quality. we wanted to have the best presentation, and we want to have, يعني, we wanted to be the first ever cookie place to have a gourmet cookie with the delivery. The delivery by itself, it's really hard. So, started in college. I started with the brand name. I called it Choowy Goowy. It's taken from the Sesame Street song. It's actually pronounced Choewy Goowy.
Oh, okay.
We didn't, because it was very hard to...
Absolutely. Can you sing the song from Sesame Street? No?
So we named it Choowy Goowy, very to be nice. Easy. And to... Chewy means, it's like chewing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You can
chewy.
Tell by the
and
dough.
Gooey, it means it melts. So when we first started, we took a place in Hawali. The rent was around. It's still there. Still the main place that deliver cookies is still there. The rent was 300. The desk was from my house. We only paid for the oven and the mixer.
Amazing.
Because these are the two most crucial elements in terms of baking. And I didn't know baking back then. My partner, Omar Nabhan, and I had another partner called Usam Al-Bannaw. Because I want to talk about this story, because a lot of people, they don't know what's the reality behind this. Usam Al-Bannaw, he's the guy who created the original recipe, which is the chocolate chip. Omar Nabhan was in the US, and I was in Kuwait. He said, I have a new shop that wants to be with me. So I told him, in order for me to start, I need to be in control.
It's a natural suggestion.
I need to, in order for me to be responsible, you need someone to blame. Always. The manager is always wrong. If any other people can take the decision for you, it will never be... You always need someone to blame in order
Absolutely.
You know, to put them on the spot. But when I went in, I've edited the recipe. And then I created all of the other recipes. I started for the first 6 months with only the original. I started in the university to reach the mass as much as I can. It was the jam at 4,000, 5,000 people. I was amshi bas masik jar. Huh? What was it? They called me the cookie dude. This is how we started. The beginning.
Super. I mean, there are a lot of beautiful products out there. There's a lot of nice cookies. You can say Choowy Goowy became a trend. What do you think makes a product trend? What's the key factor there?
I think respecting the community. احنا تقدر تقول ان our jars and mostly in most of the houses.
Yes.
إذا ما كان في cookies, في أشار, في بهارات, it's there. It's always there. Because كثر ما يعني وقتها I was always there to answer the phone. I was always there to deliver. Till now, there are few customers. Still, they call me to order cookies.
Absolutely.
يقول ما راح نطلب خاصة الحريم الكبار. I targeted الحريم الكبار.
That's the best tip.
Because the support that they gave me in the beginning, يعني كانوا يشترون 30, 40 jars was on it. فأنا شو كنت أسوي دائماً؟ Any delivery I have, I would take another two jars, one for the house on the right, one for the house. Because we didn't have any marketing tool back then. I had to do this. Sean, how people understand. We didn't have
Very
a carpet
clever,
to
actually.
Go to newspaper, ولا هذا. فكان exhibitions and TV interviews.
صح.
This is the only way. And so we wait as much as we can for الوطن back then or الراي or التلفزيون الكويت or فنون to call us in order to make an interview. We went in every home because we always knew that the best way to succeed is to respect the community. Do what they want. At the end, they are paying our salaries. It's not us. So we need to respect and do whatever they want.
I remember once you told me in, I interviewed Isa maybe, how long was it? 5 years back? I interviewed him and he said, if I put what I want on the menu, maybe I don't sell anything. So he says, it's all about the taste of the people, and you always have to keep, they're the ones, and not even the classy ones, not the ones that come and have a really good palate, and they can taste the food and tell you exactly what's missing.
Because these type of people, they don't go out.
Yeah, you want the ones that go and pay every day.
I get it for someone who comes to me 3-4 days a week. Shouldn't it be the واحد مثلا he has an amazing taste and he goes out once every 3 months?
Absolutely.
And this is what we do with tasting. This is what we do when we talk to people. We need to understand who's the person in front of you to know how to cater to the community.
Absolutely. I think with Choowy Goowy, the most impressive thing is that we all know in Kuwait we have something called a hebba, a trend. It becomes really famous. Everyone gets into it for like a month or two months. You actually withstood the test of time, which is something very rare in Kuwait. I remember once I was discussing with a very big business person in Kuwait, and I told him, yeah, I sat down with Isa, and I told him, why don't you develop your menu, do milkshakes and stuff? And he told me, are you crazy? He's like, this is the only concept that from the beginning till now, it's as successful, and they're doing everything classically and beautifully. So he's like, don't give your opinion.
In order for you to be, you need to focus. A lot of people, when they start their business, they want everything. If you focus on one single product, it will always sell. مشكلة, all business owners, وحتى اللي يبدون في البيت or whatever, the problem is they live in denial and they never admit when it's wrong. When your restaurant is not working or you're doing something wrong, it's always because of you. It's not because of there is no marketing.
Yeah.
It's not because of they don't understand what I'm doing. No, it's because of you. Only you, nothing else. كل مطعم مثلا نشتغل عليه as a consultation ولا انه مثلا outside of Kuwait ولا inside of Kuwait يقول مثلا the concept is good, everything is good, but it's not selling. Why? Location isn't a problem in Kuwait. It will never be a problem in Kuwait. The difference between a good location and a bad location is the opportunity cost. انت بدال ما تطلع 1000 دينار هنا in the very better location, you will do more, but that doesn't mean you will fail in the first one because it's a bad location. Wherever it is, if you have a good product, you need something called the competitive edge. Why should people come to you? The problem now is everybody's copying everyone. In the market, who will always stay in the market, the first, the best, and the last to enter. Those three mostly survive. Because the cycle of the business, in my opinion, especially in the F&B, how many times will you go to restaurants and you say it's not like before, or they have changed? They didn't. You've changed. When you try something really good, you will forget whatever you tasted. That's why now, in the fast food sector, it's going back because people are willing to pay 2.5 KD for a sandwich, not a meal anymore. Because their palate is always evolving. Especially when we're talking about our community, we travel in Kuwait. يعني ما شاء الله, we have the worst raw materials, but we can do the best food. This is why Kuwait, in my opinion, have the best F&B concept. Because we work with what we have. So again, it's always you. It's nothing else. Nothing else. And to go back, and I went to شوية, لما تقول هبة, هبة is a 6 months thing. It's a cycle. Because after 6 months, يقتنعون that you don't have the competitive edge. So why should they stay? So they leave. In 6 months to a year, if your sales is still going up, that means you have something special. It's not هبة anymore. And the problem is people, the owners of restaurant, they don't change or develop. They don't care about developing. They think when they do sale, they own the world. When they reach their target in the first 3 months, they think they have business. They think they can do wonders. They think they can do millions, which is totally wrong. You can think of that after minimum 3-4 years. Minimum. In order to trust that you are doing something special and analyze. You remember when you told me sometimes luck? To me, no.
Absolutely.
There is no luck in this. At all. It's what you build as a competitive edge to make people come every single day. How you know the concept is good? I'm not talking about F&B. Even with goods, even with bags, shoes, or whatever. If you don't think about it at night, after you see it, that means it's not good.
I remember once you told me in your restaurant that you actually make changes to the menu without people knowing.
Course,
you yes. keep developing the food. Is this because the back to the palate thing, that their palate is improving, so your food has to improve?
This is why you don't need to do development only for the product for yourself. You need to travel to try, you know. We predict the trend in terms of people going a bit to the spice level. So we edit, because you know your target segment, huh? You know exactly the type of people who come to you. You know exactly what do they love, what do they hate. Because most people, when they build their concept, they don't care about their target segment at all. And I will tell you one story. In Choowy Goowy, we used to reach the target very easily. Very, very easily. And then a business director came to the company, and when he saw the number, he told me, Isa, do you think that we cannot do more sale? I said, I don't think so. We can. There is a certain percentage we increased since 2005. And we already have a big share of the market. In order for you to make it bigger and bigger, it's very hard. Mm. But we are still going, escalating now. So he said, no, I think we can do 20% more sale. So I told him, I don't think so. Because the problem is, again, when you are a business owner and you do something that you really love, you always live in denial, as I said. So I thought, I know the product better than anyone, so it will never do 20% more. So he told me, who's your target segment? He asked me this. To me, it was whoever was in my age. Because since 2005, whoever I grew up with, these are the target segment I always think when I do projects. He said, focus on the eight years till 20 and see what that happened. We changed the focus in terms of social media, product, and a small development in the cooking. We reached 33% increase of sale in the next 6 months.
Wow.
Without any advertisement. We do just like what we do normally in terms of posting or whatever. This is the type of development you need to do internally.
You just change the language and the target. That's it.
And again, as the question how to change, you always need to develop your menu. Mm. Every 3 months we go back, visit the recipe, taste it, check the competition, international, and see what they are making in order for us to develop in a way, because 80% of your profit is from your existing customers. You cannot change what they love. Cannot be doing it, everybody will be. So we develop in a way that you will never notice, and we develop it in a way that when you eat it, you think that you are always eating something. This is what you love about this brand. So it's always changing your palate without anyone knowing. We try
beautiful.
As much as we can.
Beautiful. Now, you said that the entrepreneur or the anyone starting a business is always in denial.
Yes.
Okay, so what's the advice you give of getting true feedback? How can you get, because your friends are hajamlunik, they're going to say be nice. I remember yesterday he said he has a new concept which we're going to talk about later, and I had a table and he said, his friends are not going to give him good feedback. It's like, Hassan, you bring your guests are going to give you the true feedback and then you give it to me. Look how he put so much effort to getting true feedback because he knows all his friends will be nice to him. So how do you...
Your friends will never say the truth. 1 out of 10 of your friends, you would know that he's... Yani, he cares about you a lot in terms of...
I hope I'm that 1 out of 10.
No.
Oh, okay.
Your friends will never say the truth. Either they don't want to hurt your feelings, and sometimes some of them, they don't want you to be very happy or successful. We all have these type of people, especially when you are social. You know everyone. So to me, I always bring a middleman. I'll bring my brother, my friends, to invite their friends. Because they are not attached to any brand, so they will tell them exactly what do they think. And I take that and try to change it.
For the person starting at home, or for the person starting now,
I'm against everyone who starts at home.
Mm. How come? Explain.
You will never learn. Never. It's, with all the respect, it's not about financial or whatever. You can start. Most of the businessmen out there who have amazing ideas, they don't even own more than 10% of the company. This is business life. Someone has the concept and someone has the financial. You can always start. Give up 30% of your share. You want it all? You have to do it. You have to bring money in. You know what I mean? Especially, why I'm against it here? Because, mashallah, in Kuwait, you will never be hungry. Everyone has a house. You know what I mean? So it's easy. These type of things are easy for you to take the risk. And if you don't take it now, when are you going to take it? If you started at home, how are you going to price things? How you would understand? Who you would try to? What's your target segment?
Mm.
You know?
Absolutely.
And you can see them now. It's more expensive than what we do.
Let's say someone's starting a restaurant,
yes,
not home,
yeah,
and they want the true feedback or the honest feedback. How can they get it? How can they not live in a bubble or be too attached to their product?
They need to get themselves out of the circle of the business, of the operation, of the day-to-day business. Because if they are attached every single day, they can never go out. It will be an endless loop. If you are in, you will always be defensive.
Yeah.
I don't know, منكم يمكن restaurant owners, maybe chefs. If someone criticizes whatever you do, you will always be defensive.
Do we have anyone here in the food and beverage industry? One.
If someone criticizes your cake.
Two.
For example, you would defense, huh? You'd say, this is how I like it. Well, this is the way I do it. You will never say I'm wrong. In the beginning, you know what I mean? Till you understand. The problem is that it's also, لازم, you know the person in front of you. It's when he criticizes, is it valid? Well, لا. To be honest, when I do tasting, you saw me yesterday, I go to every table. Half of what they say, I don't care about.
90% of what I say, you don't care about.
But I do care about the 10%.
Okay.
out of every, each one of you have a group of friends, at least you trust one of them with whatever they say in a certain segment. In Kuwait, when you are hungry and you see an ad, even on Instagram or whatever, you won't call the number. You will call your friend and you'll ask him, did you try it? Yeah? If they said no, you'll never. If they said yes, without you even trying it, you will write it, هذا عجيب. You will say to your friends that order, and you still didn't even try it. These are the type of people I always try to understand. So when I go to tables, always in the first 3 months I'm there in the restaurant, to know exactly, because if I'm not there, the type of feedback that I'm going to receive, it's not true. If I'm there talking to them, convincing them to say the truth, sometimes I tell them, tell me. For example, yesterday, wahda, I told her, what's your best dish? I asked her, this is my favorite. She said, it's my favorite too. I gave her the common card. It was her least favorite. They always say this. So what do? I talk to them and understand which one of them, of the group of four, that my target segment is. من فيهم الأربعة. And I try to focus on only that person, what he says.
Super. I was under the impression that everyone here was in the food and beverage industry. So that's why we were asking very technical questions.
Yes.
So now we're going to go more broad, and I want to add value to everyone sitting here.
How did we grow up from a cookie to a company?
Okay, beautiful. We can do that. And then I want to talk about your blog.
Okay.
And how do you judge restaurants? How do you enjoy food? Okay. And how is it? What makes a restaurant good or bad? So tell me the story. How did you grow?
After when we started in 2005, in December, we did a sale of 1,000 KD. And here, Umar was in America, and I sent him a message. No WhatsApp, no message.
SMS.
Get now we have a business. It was 28th of December, and we sold 1,000 KD. And he was so happy. Now, from I'm talking about only a cookie brand of Choowy Goowy, not the restaurant, not other stuff which we're going to talk about later. The cookies we sold in December 1,000. Now we are selling 63 a month. Okay. The difference, all the story, because how much we failed to reach the 63. مشكلة الناس عموما دائما they talk about what they did right in order for them to succeed. It's never that way. People need to understand why did you fail? How did you fail? الشطارة in how you are a good businessman or successful is how you jumped. يعني شلون قدرت ان انت your reflex after losing something. Failure is not only about the money, that you lost money. Sometimes you fail because you didn't reach the exact target. For example, when you study a business and do target segment or feasibility study, you do the wrong feasibility study. People now, when they open a bakery, how do you know that these 25 square meter maximum, how much you can do out of it? I swear that 90% of people who do business, they don't understand this. They just want to do business in sake of doing business. They say, okay, I want to do 500 KD a day. Why? This can do up above 2,000 KD a day, maybe. So this is a failure. Even if you are doing money. So failure is not only about losing all of your money or shutting down. No, a lot of people are successful, but are يعني, failing in every aspect.
In comparison to potential.
Yes. So how did we do this? In 2008, we made up 2007. We made a yearly profit of 12,000 KD, a yearly profit in 2007, and we thought we are American. والله يعني we thought إن صدق يعني we thought إن إحنا خلاص nobody can beat us. We are the best. Which I was back then. I was 24 years. Tony, working in NBK, which and I told him, "Khalas, we don't need anything. Making money, I have a job, and we are successful." What we did, Omar came back from the state. We wanted to grow. So the uncle of Omar, Abdulaziz Nabhan, he came in. He said, what the hell are you doing? You have a product and you're not doing anything about it. We were living in denial. We thought we are much better than him. What are you talking about? We are doing 12,000 KD a year. No one can do that. والله يعني we were يعني خلاص. So he said, why don't we grow it into a company? And you guys leave your jobs. I said, okay, let's give it a try. We took the risk. He said, next year, if you didn't reach the target, both of you are fired. That was in June 2008. In June 2008. So we decided to buy an existing company. In order for us to go full-fledged, we couldn't take a Shamia or Choowy Goowy as a company and make it public or wrong it in the مشكلة always الرخص. We wanted a company that it's there, ready. So we went to شركة دواجن المتحدة and we bought Texas chicken back then in 2008. How did we do it? We didn't have any money at all. So I convinced them. I went and asked around which are the companies which are losing money because I didn't have money to pay. So we've decided to pay to buy companies on debt. They wanted just to leave the company. They didn't want anything. Buy it with its debt. So we bought a 1.4 million debt. 1.4 million KD worth of debt. Oh. They had 12 stores of Texas chicken and an office, and 100 employees or 120. And we took that risk, and we thought that we are a CEO, GM, and we can. It's easy to take. Yeah, we are doing 12,000 KD a year. We can do whatever. So in reality, when we took over the company, Omar was the chairman. I was the GM. The first thing I did, without going into the financials and so looking into Texas Chicken how to fix it, I decided to develop Choowy Goowy, grow on beans. So we went to Avenues, and they gave us the location of the bakery in phase two. And we had a huge fight, me, Omar, and Osama. Osama didn't want to go. He was, in terms of risk, he didn't want to take the risk. And to me, I couldn't succeed if he wasn't there. Because I was very good in what I do in terms of marketing and talking to people, trying to sell, editing recipe. He was very good in operation, making sure that the quality of cookies is on point every single day. Especially people who don't understand, baking is so hard. It's not like cooking at all. If you think cooking is hard, don't go into baking. Okay? So he decided, no. And he decided that I want out of the company. It's either we don't go into Avenues, or we stay where we are and don't develop. وهذا للحين احنا we didn't touch the chicken. We didn't do anything. This is the first step that we took. Because when you go to Avenues, a small company with three people, they will not. And back then, كان ما في business Kuwaitian wide. يعني always can be franchise, my franchise. So Avenues gave us the location. We had a huge fight. We decided that Osama decided that he will sell his share, which was 20% of the company. And he wanted premium because we were doing profit. So he asked for 90,000 KD.
But he's in debt.
No. That's Choowy Goowy, Shamir. Still, we didn't touch Al-Manar, which is the Texas chicken. That's all Shamir. Okay. It was 100%. I used to own 20. Omar used to own 70. 60. And Osama, 20. Osama, the 20% was around 40,000. He said, if you want me out, you have to pay 90. And it says right. So Abdul Aziz, the owner, came and told me, "Khalas, I will not. You will not go to Avenues, and you will stay. And please focus on Al Manar, only Texas Chicken." I decided no. I told him, "Pay those 90,000, and I will give you the same profit in a year and a half." Usually the return on assets is always about 3 to 5 years. I'd never like to put it on 5 years because the F&B with our market, it should be on 3. Don't stretch yourself when you do your feasibility study, making it on 5 years. Always push yourself to the limit. If you put it in 5 years, you will be relaxed. So he said, "Are you sure?" He said, "If you didn't give me the target, I'll tell him I will give you my 20%. I always push myself to the limit and put myself in risk in order for me to get the best. How many of you in الامتحان ما يدرس إلا آخر يوم? Because you feel pressure. Huh? Because you feel pressure. And you get so creative. He agreed. We bought Osama out, which was a huge loss, in my opinion, till that day. If he was still with us, I think we would be much, much better. Much, much better. Anyway, we start in April with Choowy Goowy, and I still didn't touch Texas. We made it run as it is till we open.
And it was losing on a monthly basis.
It was losing on a monthly basis. I couldn't do it because I couldn't focus on both. But we couldn't close any of the stores, so we have to keep them. So we knew that we're going to lose more money. We're going to lose around 250,000 KD more.
Wow, you say it so lightly. I mean, I will tell you. You were confident because you were making 12.
I'm confident because I was making 12. I'll tell you now how we overcome this. Because we had a pillow. We had a sport. But if we lose, they're going to cover us up to $500,000 as the mother company. Okay. When we bought the debt, they said we will inject around $500,000 KD to help you guys start. Choowy Goowy in the first year, I thought that we were successful. Everybody knows. We used to do a lot of sales. When we opened Avenues, I realized that we didn't even have a business. When I was there, around 200, 300 people come a day, nobody knows. And that was the biggest failure, in my opinion, that I thought that I, yani, and the people knows. يعني احنا كان لو بس فريج اللي عرفنا in order to limit. So I was targeting only that segment. That يعني علمني ان don't underestimate what your product or yourself are capable of doing. You need to take the risk. In the first year, we did a profit of 120,000 and we covered the purchasing debt. And till now it's there. It's making really good, and we're going to close it in the next month to redo everything. Al-Manar, Texas Chicken. When we focused on Al-Manar, who have tried Texas Chicken? What do you think of it?
I really like the corn nuggets.
Okay.
I'm not a chicken person. Okay. I realized that.
And the Texas Chicken. The first, I'm going to talk about the brand, how people living in denial can make business go really wrong. The first branch that they opened in Mishrif, it used to make more money than KFC. Double.
Wow.
Double. That had a killer before we came. I will tell you how they ended up with 12 and losing all of the money.
Wow.
Because what we do in business nowadays, we define the problem, we don't solve it. Anybody can solve any problem. To define a problem, it's 90% of the solution. If I tell you exactly what my problem is, of course you will solve it. So we try as much as we can study and define what are the problems. After that, when they are doing a lot of money, they went greedy. They wanted more profit margin. In fast food business, the cost of goods or the cost of food is up to 45%. 45% cost of food. That means when you pay 10 KD, technically the restaurant is paying 4.5 for what you are eating. That's without the packaging, without the service, without the rent, without.
It's considered, just to give, what's the average on a normal restaurant compared to fast food?
A normal restaurant, it's up to 20 to 25.
So how come fast food is that much higher?
Because of the high turnover and low sale. You have to go low in your profit margin in order for you high turnover.
So it's quantity versus...
I'll tell you something. KFC or McDonald's, they sell around, adi, one store, a million. But their profit from that million is nothing. It's very minimal. But they do, when you sell a million, a 10% out of a million, or 5% out of a million,
it's a lot of money.
It's a lot. يعني غير لما يكون you have 20% profit margin of 30,000 KD. You understand? So fast food is a total. You have casual, you have fast food, and you have hotels, which is catering. Okay? And it's two different categories. Cost of sale in the F&B, which is normal restaurants, is 20 to 28 maximum. Anything more than that, it's going to be a suicide. Why? Because with these type of restaurants, which are the casual, the rent is high. It's much higher than a fast food chain because of the space. You need someone who talks really well as a waiter. So he's expensive. Rather than paying 150 in terms of salary, you end up paying 300. You need a better chef. So your overheads are really, really high. You know, At the end, the maximum profit margin you can do from a restaurant is 15%. Any restaurant that does more, there is a problem. There is something not right at all. Either he's charging really a lot, which is by time people will leave you because they would understand that it's the value versus price isn't there. So fast food is really high. So he decided that he wanted to bring it down as Texas chicken. So he changed from fresh chicken to frozen. He changed from Heinz ketchup to ketchup Oman. He changed from crinkle cut fries to a normal fries. He changed the bread, the Texas bread, which is famous. He didn't use to have it. The yield was longer, so he brought even like the nearly expired yield.
Wow.
People notice, especially in Kuwait, don't give them bad food. لأن ما في أحسن منا نقول عن هذا تغير. When we eat something, we always want it to be good. If you try be smart, never be smart when you go to the quality. So what did he do? He sacrificed the quality in order to make profit. He did. Because still people didn't notice. Because they are the existing customers, which are the 90% of your profit or 80%, are still coming. Then with time, he saw this profit margin is high, so he decided, now I'm going to go full-fledged. And he took 5 locations in 3 months. Then people noticed that the quality is really bad, really, really bad. Then he started losing. When he saw there is no sale, he went even below as a quality and the cost of food, bringing even much worse product. Still, he went to same cycle, to a 12 store, and losing everything. Even the one in Mishrif is not making money anymore. So we stepped in. We bought the company. We wanted to change the whole locations to our own brands. What the mistake that we did? We didn't read the franchise
agreement
well. That's another failure.
What was it? You weren't allowed to close?
They own the location. You don't. In the franchise deal, they own the location. Any franchise deal, in any franchise agreement, they own the location, it's not you. If you want to sell it, if you want to close it, you can't. Even if it's losing. Because to them, they take 5% out of the sale. You know? So they don't care. They just need more money. That's why in any franchise deal, they will tell you, minimum open 5 or 7 or 6. So they can make as much money as they want. So we went to them, we decided to close the really losing store. They agreed. In the first 2 years, we went to break even. We brought the fresh chicken back. We brought everything back. We had an increase of 30%. But our reputation was so bad. Whatever we tried to do, you can never get them back. Khalas. They committed brand suicide. When you commit a brand suicide, whatever you do, there is no any marketing strategy, nothing, especially after 4 years of opening, or 5 years of opening. It would never. It's different when you open something in a month, it didn't do well, and you try to do a marketing strategy for it. And then the last 2 years, Texas Chicken came, 3 years, and said, to renew our contract, you need to pay $1 million. We've decided that we don't want it anymore. And we did it. Since day one. So we pulled out and we used the location for ourselves. Then I've created the brand called RV Burger. We had a lot of burger concepts in Kuwait. I've decided I want to create the brand which has a competitive edge. I thought that no one is doing a veal burger. Not only veal, milk-fed veal. I focused on a very small, narrow segment. It's different when you focus on 100 people, and at the end, maybe 10 will come to you because the competition is really hard. I focused on a very small segment of people who don't like meat as much. I opened an RV burger in Grain and a delivery in Ardia and in Kuwait City, and we focused on that segment. And it was much more successful than what we had in Texas Chicken. So we've decided to go full-fledged with it. Back then, before we created RB, I've decided that in order for me, because we had a vision to have an F&B company that can be successful for the next 20 years or 30 years, we needed a backbone. The backbone was a central kitchen. We didn't have a central kitchen. So we've decided, because we learned from our mistakes, and we made Al-Manar break even, and now profitable, along with Choowy Goowy and everything else. We decided to do the exact same practice with a catering company. We chose a losing catering company, and we bought the debt. The total debt of Al-Manar was 1.2, again, with whatever we lost, so it was 1.4 plus. In 2012, it was breaking even. Only the debt, which has the 3 months debt in terms of supplying, which is a normal, which is 200,000. We bought a Rivera catering company to be the foundation of the mother company, to help us be the support of any new business that we want to build. And we did the exact same practice we did with Al-Manar. We defined what are the problems, how to bring money in, and we did it. And this is the story of how we went from a cookie place to a company. We've just created the restaurant. We opened 3 different restaurants, because I'm going to go into details after that. So we built this company. From a 3,000 KD capital to 7 million KD capital, without injecting a lot of money. We took everything on debt. We pushed ourselves to, not us, the board pushed us to the limit, made us feel not secure about our job, made us feel that it's not a lifetime job. They pushed us to the limit. This is one of the main reasons that we took it up to 7 million.
Beautiful.
That's how we built Al-Manar, by having a subsidiary from RV Burger, Al-Shamia company and Rivera company. And now we have a Fuel Superfoods company, which is with Diet Ninja. We do pre-packed meals every month. We have RV Burger, 3 locations. We have Choowy Goowy Bakery, 2 central kitchen and 1 location in Avenues. And we have the Choowy Goowy restaurant. We used to be in Phase 1 Avenues, 52 degrees, and Village. We became very successful in the restaurant that is doing much more money than anything else. But we failed miserably in the branding because we called it Choowy Goowy. Again, failure is not about the money. We made people confused. What is the bakery? A lot of people maybe here, they don't know we have a restaurant. Maybe. And some people come to us and only buy cookies. Or when you say, I'm going to eat in Choowy Goowy, you will tell them, oh, my Mubas cookies. So there was misleading information. We discovered that after 3 years. Look how sometimes we live in denial. Huh? Mm-hmm. We want to capitalize on the name, so the best way to do it. No. So we've decided to separate. Choowy Goowy has always been the cookie place and a bakery. Now it's going to be a full-fledged bakery. We took a place in Promenade, Hawali, the new mall in Uthman, which has the tempo. It's going to be full-fledged bakery. طبعاً الأساس هو cookies, along with desserts that do with cookie dough. 80% of the dessert is infused with our cookies. And we decided to name the restaurant Jar. Jar by Choowy Goowy. We closed the one in 52, because 52 as a whole concept shuts down. We took a location in Phase 3 Avenues, because when we did Sahara, we gave them the presentation. They decided that they wanted on Phase 3 instead of Red Lobster, the folk. And we have the one in Village. So all of the restaurant will be Jar by Choowy Goowy. And this is how we solved this failure. But after 3 years, yes, we did a lot of money from the bakery and from the restaurant, but we failed miserably. We could have done maybe much, much more. And we failed miserably in terms of professionalism. The brand, not taking care of the brand name. This is all, do you know why? Because I delegated. I brought a creative director to the company and a business director. The first thing that they did, change the name. I was laughing at them. No way. Never. Because I told them, what, you want me to lose all of this money? They convinced me and everyone else that you have to change the name. You have to. And because we failed in a lot of things, we learned how to trust other people and to delegate. You reach to a certain point that you have to delegate. You cannot be the only reason for anything. We bring good people not to be managed. They manage us. Good people don't need to be managed. I want to bring someone to learn from. Why should I bring someone very weak and teach him? The exact same thing of me, so I can do it alone. You need to partner up with someone or to have a manager who can teach you. It's not the other way around. To learn from, to understand how he can see the how to define problems better than you. And this is what we did. Since then, the growth of the company went massively in sales after hiring really good, educated employees. Kuwaitis. We have a team now of 8 Kuwaitis in Al-Manar company as a whole business development group.
And of course, you named it Jar to pay respect to the jar of the Choowy Goowy.
It started always in the jar. We will never serve anything in the jar. Okay? But it all started. Jar is transparent, jar is quality.
Jar is very close to your heart, correct? Yes. Why? Tell them, because you handpicked every single.
Jar was كل التعب for the past 10 years. نحط الجار. The whole team that I brought in was for Jar. I used to focus only on food. I used to focus only on doing something what people love. Since 2003, Essa Behbehani.
Essa Behbehani was in. Just
here
explain
I,
what
I,
the.
I knew that I can do this, but I didn't. When I took Jar, I went to Cordon Bleu in London. I tried. I couldn't take the full diploma because it was. I couldn't leave work that long, 9 months. Then they did a course of 6. I couldn't do that. So I took as much as I can over there. They do short courses. I took around 8, 9. I went in the kitchen every single day. Every single day. And yet I still, every year I think that I know everything. Khalas now. The next year I say, what the hell I was doing?
Wow. That's every progress.
Year.
That's
Every year. Why? Because you bring in people with you, and they will let you feel that no, you don't know anything.
Have you guys tasted the Essa Behbehani and Maki?
Of course.
Yeah, it was named after him. Yeah.
Yeah,
I didn't know. At first, when I met him, like we became really close, and then he's like, "Yeah, I remember Essa." I was like, "You're Essa? Essa Behbehani? Like it's amazing." Yeah, the sales of Maki actually. Rose from his.
What we did with Maki back then, we after doing that dish, they started to capitalize on the same thing. This is how smart they were.
Absolutely. Okay, let's talk about in general your love for food. First of all, what's your favorite restaurant of all time?
There is first favorite dishes, not favorite restaurant.
Okay, top three. But then you have to give us top three favorite dishes.
Top three, no, I will tell you restaurants.
Okay.
I love Zuma. Zuma is one of my favorite restaurants. There is a restaurant in London called Dinings. It's a Japanese tapas place I love. And These are the only two in my mind now. Yeah. But when you say what do you like, well, what do you hate, or how, I have to visit the restaurant at least 3 to 5 yeah. times.
And your Thai place in...
that's my favorite restaurant, sorry.
Bataya
in Kuwait City. That is my favorite.
He keeps telling me there's this restaurant. It's ghetto, but you love it. It's ghetto, but you love it. Still haven't tried it. On Instagram and Snapchat, if you go to Qeats, spelled Kuweats, this is Isa's blog. This is where he gets to share his experiences. And then at the end of every segment, he puts a rating for the restaurant. So tell us about these ratings. Tell us how you rate a restaurant, what makes it good value for money, and the whole restaurant experience in general.
Restaurants, when you go visit a restaurant, the problem is people will always judge it from the first time.
There's a famous thing you say.
I can take you to the worst restaurant ever and order you the one good dish that they have. And to you, it will be your best restaurant. When a lot of restaurants close, you will find someone, Nish, sucker, because they loved a certain dish over there. And I can take you to the best restaurant ever and order for you one of the worst dishes. And you say, I try as much as I can to evaluate the restaurant from 3 to 4 visits, order 70% of the menu, and you see me how I order. So
yes.
I try as much, because this is what I love doing. And in order for me to do that at the end, there is a value versus price. When you buy things, it's a bag, it's a food, whatever, you say it's not worth it. There is always a value versus price. Always. That's always considered in food. People sometimes, for example, I will say, pick the pistachio sauce. People freeze the thing, and they make sure that they have enough stock. For example, whatever brand that Hermes or whatever, people are willing to pay double the price to get a bag. To them, it's value versus price. So in restaurants, there is a value versus price in terms of quality, okay, and what you love. So here it depends on the target segment and what is the purchasing power. If I bring someone who doesn't like food and make him pay 20 KD per person, he will hate the restaurant. He will never come back. And that's why when we do a restaurant or pick a location, we check two things, tenant mix and parking. And that's one of the main problems, for example, in Arabella. There are restaurants there that are not working well, not because they are not good. There is not enough parking space for their target segment. So for example, you will find Cheesecake Factory is big, you have two other shisha places. They have around 3,000 chairs in Arabella with 300 parking space. 300. If you have 300 cars, with each car is 4 people, that's what? Yeah. Still, it's not enough. So when you
come... 1,200.
If you came to a very good restaurant that serves... Now you see the tenant mix. Most of the tenant mix is a low purchase power. Okay? So who is willing to pay 10 KD or more and go and want to eat the restaurant which serves the same target segment? There is no parking for it. There is no parking for it. That's the problem in Arabella. That's the problem in Al-Bida. There is a lot of things in the Bida, but you don't even think of going there because you know that you will never find a parking. Well, a good way is Ahmed. You know what I mean? This is how you do the study. You study, why I'm saying this, because this is the main reason of value versus price. Because you need to study your target segment, how can they reach you, in order to eat and pay for the money. So this is mostly how I rate. Yeah.
Super. I have a question. In jar, what's your favorite dish in jar?
Fish and chips. Fish and chips, yes.
Okay, super. I think our time is up, so I just want to say thank you for... taking the time of being here, but we do have questions and answers now. So if anyone would like to ask, this is your chance.
If you don't agree with me, tell me why. In order for me to answer or for any everyone benefit, you need to disagree. Ask whatever you want, even if you think what I said is wrong, and I said, ask whatever you want.
And you guys remember before he said he only cares about 50% of what people say? So he probably ignore what.
When you said about locations, when you talked about locations,
yes.
And you've mentioned that it wasn't the problem. For me, as a customer of Choowy Goowy, the three locations that were closed, the problem for me was not the food, was not the branding, it was the location.
Which location?
The village,
yes.
52 degrees. The third one, the yes. Avenue, it's in a bad location.
100%. Because our target segment, in terms of who we were targeting, the sale was most important on delivery. Okay. And we were reaching our target in our feasibility study. You know what I mean? So these locations were amazing.
No, but for example, if it was in a better location in the avenues, I would have come.
This is where we, I'm coming. Now, when we did JAR and we decided to change, if I put JAR in phase one, it will never work. It will work, but it will not give me what I want in terms of profitability level, because again, I will do a feasibility study. Who do I want? How much would I want at the end of the month? So we decided to close phase one and go to phase three. You understand what I mean?
I have a question that is around what you said. So avenues, all of us in Kuwait, I don't know if you're looking for to open a restaurant or a shop. The main problem nowadays is the pulu.
Yes.
So the avenues is yes. The most expensive pulu in all of Kuwait. How do you deal with that?
Buy a house instead.
I will give you two different Sahara. We didn't pay for it. The location is amazing. We will make much more money than half. And we will not pay for it. Okay? Avenues, we think that we have to be there, because with our own study, it's the only mall for the next 10 years.
So it's a window for the world.
It's a window that there's a brand position. To me, I want to go to Kharij in the brand. How I can, again, feasibility study for the next 5 years. I want to franchise JAR by next year, December 2016. Yeah, in order for me to do that, I have to be in certain places to convince someone to buy the franchise. How can I do that? By taking a location. In the beginning, I didn't want to franchise the restaurant. That's why I took in these places. You understand? But village made me change everything because the amount of sale we are doing. And why the location isn't important? Because in village, I would say this, so we are the only place that's making money. I'm being very serious. We are, and all of
the I live there, and it's very
the
empty.
The
whole
are calling
the whole
me area. To not pay rent. I said, I'm making money. The problem is with you. It's not with the place. Yes, the place is a mess. But I'm making money. I'm reaching more than what I want in terms of target. Because I know exactly who to target. I'm afraid to change it.
But you're delivering to them. They're not coming to the shop.
No, they're coming. And every day at night, I'm full. Not lunchtime, but at night. Lunchtime because of the weather. But in winter, lunch and dinner. Okay? Now I'm afraid to change it to job. I'm afraid. That's why I'm keeping 30% of, because the segment is different. Yeah.
One more question,
yes.
When do you believe it's the right time to franchise? After how many branches you open from the concept?
Amazing question.
That will take me to a whole new, because I wrongly franchised you. I did one of the biggest mistakes of my life. When I franchised you.
You franchised it to where?
First, I franchised them to Qatar, and they opened in Dubai. I will tell you the Qatar problem and Dubai problem. When anyone came to me, I want to franchise to Dubai. I want to, even if you take it free of charge.
I want to reach and I want people to know it all.
It was too fast. You didn't solve your own problems. Why you make other people problems? We succeeded, yes. We did a lot of money, yes. But we failed miserably. In terms of not protecting the ground or how it's supposed to.
You have to just know something. I want you to filter what he says. When he says failure, for many of us, maybe it's not a failure. You know what I mean? But he says standards are very high, you know? Like I've spoken.
You do a study, there's a certain target. This is opportunity cost, as I said. You should do much more. With time, you will learn that you need to predict. You cannot live. You need to build a business, not a product. Some people build their business around the product. It's wrong. You need to, don't think of selling a product. Think of selling a business. Okay? So we franchised to Doha, and we weren't ready. We opened in Doha. We did a lot of money, but in 6 months' time, when the demand came, we want more, I freeze. I couldn't help it, because I didn't reach that point here. Because in Qatar, for example, the target segment is totally different than Kuwait. In Kuwait, I can only do cookies. 1 hour, I don't bake cookies, I lose a lot of money. That's why I don't do anything else, because I utilize the ovens to bake only cookies. I wanted to do cheesecake, carrot cake. When I took them off, they used to sell. But the opportunity cost of not baking batches is making me lose a lot of money. And then we went into Dubai. We went into partnership with Mohammed. We took a location. It was making good. Then we decided we want to go to Dubai Mall. We took the worst location ever in Dubai Mall. Mohammed was too smart. Said I don't want to be involved. I was too stupid to take it. We bought the mount. We paid 60% of the company because we went in as a sweat equity. We didn't want to go as a franchise. We wanted to sweat equity. They did the investment. In another year, we bought them out. They lost only, I think, 10% of their initial investment. Okay? We went into Dubai Mall. He brought us a kiosk in front of the ice rink. They gave us the whole ice rink. I went blind. When they told me the whole ice rink, yes, I want to take it. And because it was the same rent, over 30 square meter booth, or less, 25, and a 668 square meter booth.
Wow.
To me, I thought only about rent.
What was the problem?
The place is huge. I had to pay 300,000 KD to do the place. I lost it all in 10 months. That's all it pays, and what we paid for the initial investment and everything. We opened, we did good sale. We were breaking even the first 6 months. Then I decided that in order for me to make a lot of money from it, I have to make birthday parties. We started making profits. Because now we are on track. And we know in 2 years, we will have the return on asset, which is amazing. Dubai Mall sent me an email. You have 2 weeks to clear the place.
In your agreement, they were allowed to do that.
The mistake was not the location of my agreement. Because we made money. The mistake that we did, that we went as a subcontract with the Iceland and the cinema, which they can kick you off. It's either 1 year lease or 3 year lease. We signed 1 year. And they will, renew. Because I didn't want to pay more rent. But they are allowed to kick you even with the 3 year. Because Elevation Burger came in and took the place. To them, it was much better a brand name. So I lost around 500,000 KD in exactly 4 years.
It's okay, you were making 12 before.
So again, we learned from these mistakes. Because of that, I have an amazing franchise manual now. Because of that, I know how to enter Dubai again. We have millions, hundreds of people want Choowy Goowy in Dubai. I would never go there. They are willing to pay a franchise fee of $200,000. And we can make so much money out of it. But I would never go there. Now, I know now it's not the time. I went to Riyadh.
to me, it was the best move ever. And the mistake that I did, I didn't went into a partnership. I thought the same mistake would happen. You understand what I mean?
Riyadh is what? It's franchise.
Riyadh, all the franchise. And Riyadh, they wanted to give us sweat equity, the same deal as Dubai. I said, no. Now I regret it. Why I'm saying this? You need to calm down when any opportunity comes to you. See what people did before you. How did they fail? See what our restaurants are doing. Who's the best? Why people close? Define why. In order for you to learn.
If the cookie you make, the cookie you make in the restaurants,
yes.
If you high up the price every year, you know, it's like half KD.
Yes.
Imagine it reached 10K.
Yes.
This do you think people will
buy it? When we start in 2004, our cookie jar, the dozen, is 2K. Yeah. Now it's 3K. We predicted. When you do a feasibility study, you need to predict the inflation and the pricing. So in order for you, don't change the price every year. That's why you need to be not, you don't need to be greedy in business. Be very careful. You think of the turnover and value versus price. Don't think of just selling. This is the problem on all business, in my opinion. Their products are really high without overhead. So the value versus price isn't there, you know?
Yeah.
That's the main problem. And they charge you for delivery. And it's okay with people. But when business charge for delivery, it's not. See, all of the business, they don't charge for delivery. And all of the home business, they charge for the delivery. How come? You know? So, it's 2KD, now it's 3KD. And you refill the jar and take half KD risk. Okay? We predicted the inflation back in 2008 that we will go up maximum till next year to 3.5. But what I did to stay here, where we play with the average margin, we did other products so we don't make the high sale items go up to always stay the same. This is why in restaurants you pay half a KD for a Coca-Cola. And it's 150. Why? Because they try to do as much profit margin from the drinks to not charge you as much the food. Plus, you want to sit in a restaurant, a good restaurant, the best seating, the best waiter, best food, and you want to pay only 200 for a Coke? It's not feasible. So I hope this answered the question in terms of questions. Any other?
You look like you have a question.
Actually, I do. Yes. I'm really interested to know about the pricing.
Okay.
In regards to any meal you introduce or already have, how do you price that meal?
First of all,
innovation.
The main thing is costing. It cannot be more than 30%. The dish as a whole, with garnish, with everything. And then you study the dish in terms of, you predict how much is it sell for the meal. Is it will be a high demand? Because when we do a menu, we know exactly which dishes are going to be ordered a lot, which are not. We know. So for example, the dishes like a steak, or a very good steak, we go up to 60% cost of food. Because I cannot sell you the steak for 30 KB, I'm not a steak person. But I want to bring the best steak. Usually you multiply by 3 to price anything. But when I multiply the salad by 3, it will be 1 KD. So all of the salad that you see in restaurants are much cheaper. Maximum half KD. And we all charge it 3 KD, minimum. An appetizer, we try as much as we can, also take a good margin. So on the main course, we don't take as much. you predict your food mostly is going to be people order from the appetizer or the main course. Here you decide, you want to have good desserts or bad desserts. How? when we study, when you do a restaurant, the first thing we say after introducing the concept, we will say a dessert. How about? Do we want high turnover on tables? So people finish after, we don't want, we will just put normal dessert. That's why Japanese restaurants, they don't focus on dessert because they need very high turnover. Okay? Because if you put a dessert, you will lose at least 4 tables a day. Because people will stay another half an hour. I'll set them back to that. If you put an Arabic coffee or whatever, they will stay forever. You will lose a lot of money. But there's either you focus on the concept. I prefer focusing on the concept. Because again, you do again your feasibility study. And you want, what do you want people to taste? You want them to taste the really good dessert? To have the full experience. So this is how we do the pricing. Yes, we will get maybe 20% increase of sale if we put dessert. If I don't put dessert, I'll get another table. Or get 3-4 tables there, no, but if I don't put dessert. So this is how we do.
And if you go to Jar, you have to taste the steak.
It's really,
yeah, it's really good.
I'm not sure how to ask it though. This is kind of for myself.
He is married.
I'm too old. When you first opened in Avenues.
You mean the bakery or the restaurant?
The restaurant upstairs.
The restaurant? The phase one? Ah, no, that's the bakery.
No, not the restaurant. Yeah, okay. The bakery. And you were selling cookies. I was looking for desserts for my sons, especially the one who's back here, who has food allergies,
yes.
Especially nuts.
Yes.
And when we first went there, he started buying them. In fact, he was a regular customer because the cookies were made in separate stations.
Yes.
So there was kind of an understood guarantee that there wouldn't be any tainting of peanuts,
yes,
or the tree nuts,
yes,
or so forth. But lately, he says that's not the case anymore. So are you still, I didn't know if that was a target for you, because that's really not a target yet in Kuwait, unfortunately, even though a lot of children have food allergies. So I was just wondering, would that change? Or?
We used to always put nuts free, not about cookies.
That was it, yes.
We always are. We took it off. People have allergies, they will always take it. Yes, and we never mix. Because when you do a patches, when you do bakery, you do it by patch. Each patch, when you finish the patch, everything needs to be sanitized.
Yeah.
And do another patch. We don't mix patches together. Because we take in the order, you know what I mean? And we decided to take it from the sticker because it's lowering in terms of the brand value. Because people, when they have allergies, they always say, you know, they always say. But yes, we still do it.
So the quality control
was
still there in terms,
yes, of course.
So he just has to tell them and then they'll be able
to. The problem is the quality of people, the staff, quality of staff. We have the problem is that we have a hard labor and minimum wages here. You know? So the type of people, because we pay a lot of rent, huge rent and the overheads, we need to bring local staff in order for us to make that. So that's why sometimes the message, that's why we need training and development internally in order for people to understand.
Where did you first learn how to bake?
Bake? I never knew how to bake. I said in the beginning that for summer, I only know how to do cookies. I hate baking.
So how did you
learn? It drives me crazy. In food, when I do something wrong, I can easily change it. If the food is salty, I know exactly what to do. If there is something wrong, you can fix it. With baking, you need to wait. The full process, you will never know till it's out of the oven. I can't take it. So I only know how to do cookies. On. With baking, on.
I think you stressed them out a bit.
Because a lot of people think I'm not a baker. The problem is that I have with Choowy Goowy, that when I develop it upon my prediction. Because it's very sensitive, I don't bring chefs in because of the recipe. So I'm very protective. Lately, I didn't care. A lot of concepts in Kuwait took our recipe. And some of them are famous. In Kuwait. You know? To me, I decided whoever wants the recipe, whoever will take the recipe, take it, but you are not sure. We do the ready mix. But it will never be Choowy Goowy without the ready mix. So nobody will know it. But yes, if you take our recipe without the ready mix, you can do a good cooking. You can do a good cooking. So,
lately, what's a ready mix?
Ready mix is just. A certain ingredients would change. It's a mix which is ready. Is it? So that's what we do. Now, lately, I don't care. If anybody wants to resign, go. And they go to other cookie places. Huh? Why? Well, go. They are working with cookie making. Because they cannot bake. They learn a recipe. They didn't learn how to bake. Yeah, the baker, you would understand. If the egg was small, the whole recipe changes.
Wow.
If the baking soda is different, the whole recipe changes. So if you give him another oven, he will not understand, because we don't bring in chefs. But lately, I bring in chefs, try to develop, because I cannot live in denial again. No. Since we did this, it's doing really good. What's that? Restaurant? Both of them are totally different than each other.
I think cafe is lower ticket price. You need more
lower ticket price,
more quantity,
but much higher amount. Because in a cafe you sell drinks and salads and small sandwich. Sandwich you would buy for 2 KD. Technically, the cost of it is 200 or 300. So you are selling it with a huge profit margin. But the problem is, in order for me to do a 1,000 KD in a restaurant, I need 100 chairs to be full. 100. In order for me to do 1,000 in a cafe, I need 400 people to come. Along the day. In a restaurant, 2 hours. If I had 100 chairs, I can do. We do, for example, job, if it's full, with one seating, we can do 2,000. With the outside seating area. With one seating, I mean, in terms of, with a bit of turnover, people, a full dinner service. At 2,000 people, for 3 hours. Hectic, but it's guaranteed. That's why we know exactly how much you can able to make. But with cafes, you need a lot of people. A lot, in order to do the same. But it has much better margin. Much better. They will reach the same target as you are. Both of you will get a 1,000 KD. But my profit margin from this is 8 to 12%. And the cafe will be above 20. But it will take him much more time, much more effort to get that.
Can you cut costs a little bit?
You remember when I told you the three elements of business? You always compromise the price. Never the cost. Don't be greedy. Never. Because again, that's the problem with people starting at home. Because they don't do the right study. When a home business decides to go, in a shop, they need to pay at least 800, 700 KD rent. Drivers, permits, all of these problems. Before they didn't choose to pay anything. Even most of the salaries is paid at home. So their pricing is not on a solid base. It's very fragile. That's why most of the whole business stay at home. So never compromise the quality. Never. Because they will come to you no matter where you are. When you have the quality, if you have a good cake, I will come to you. If you have a good burger or a good meal, I will go. Now in Kuwait it's totally different. there's a Japanese cuisine or an American. Now all of them are competition. If the Indian cuisine is much better than the Japanese, I will not go to them. I will always go to them. It's not a segment
of... It's the experience.
It's the experience. This is the way I see it.
You have a question.
You can start at home. You can learn.
Yes,
but don't sell. What's the difference between opening a very small shop? Because when you're starting at home, it's a delivery, yeah? Huh? When you start at home, when you start at home, 99% of home business is delivery.
Right.
Or a takeout. So what's the difference between starting at home or anywhere in Kuwait with a very low cost of مشاكل الرخص والشغلات حق الشركات شوية كبيرة. Small businesses has never a problem مع الرخص. لا تصدقين هالكلام. اللي يواجهون مشكلة اللي يبي يستارت بيت. لأن ما يعطونا صدق. واحد. أقول لك when you start big مشكلة كبيرة.
Saying if you need more than 4 or 5 staff. Or my 5 staff they give you automatically.
When you go, it will take you 21 to 27 days to take a loss. After that, you will do the place. It's finished. It needs another month to give you the show and what the fee. And they will give you 4 to 5. What's the problem? If you want to open a small business, I'm saying small, huh?
Same delivery, same capacity.
I'm saying, then enter that situation. You will never have a problem with Arafus. Will you go to under the. Sorry, but. He didn't like. ما عندك مشكلة. Everything finishes with small businesses. بس أنت أول مرة جاي تبي تفتح مطعم 200 متر, yes you will have a problem. This is a problem in Kuwait. Which everybody is facing. This is a small business. Like delivery, take a small place. حولي مش كثر المحلات. مو حولي, روح بالعربية. محلات على 400, 500. What you can't buy an oven? Buy a used oven. You understand? Buy whatever.
I think the main problem is people these days, they're looking to make either money on the side or they're looking for a quick buck. No one is looking to create
a
company.
You can never make money without investing. Easy money will go easy.
Yeah.
That's why home businesses are, I don't have a salary. Who is good in home business? I don't have a salary. اللي يحتار ان people salon more than 4 or 5 years they think home business they will never learn it's a year give yourself a year maximum انا اللي خلقي لما اطلب البيت because it's not fair والله it's not fair especially تدريب من في segment واحد في 2 segments متأثرين بالhome business before it was cookies when you started بس الحمد لله we didn't get it. Other people were cake or catering. The catering, a lot of catering are out of business because of home. Why? Because they will charge you 600 people for a 1,500 KD. Catering companies, they cannot charge you less than 4,000 KD. And people who invite mass, they will care about the price, not anything else. Second, the cakes. The cake industry, home business is taking over big time. In my opinion, the only survivor and the best is caramel. Everyone else, you cannot even compete with home business. That's why home business is taking everything and caramel is taking everything. November is amazing in terms of, not packing in terms of events, but as a customer, caramel is the home business of businesses. Because they don't want to grow. It's passion for them, it's not business. But they did it, not in home, in the store. That's why they are really good. And everything they do, people love them. Because you feel love when people bake. You understand how it is.
So nowadays we see integration of technology with the food industry. Is there anything that
when you talk, sorry, technology in terms of
whether it's menus that are menus and many reviews online, whether it's whenever you walk in, they know you're ordering in advance and they throw in something. There's also an app that we can have in startup businesses. What you do is you support that local business by prepaying for your orders. They can.
Is there a request manual?
Is there anything that you see?
Because of the tablet.
How so?
Is there a request? With food, we like to interact. Okay? أنا لو إحنا لما نطلع نسافر we do it but when we come to Kuwait we don't do it. If I tell you about a restaurant like this in London you will go to it. Say wow but it's here yeah you will pay 30 KD per person in London but when you come here you دعوة غالية ماذا سوى تاني it's psychological show but to me these type of things and the food industry I don't think it would affect a lot, especially in restaurants. Cafes is different when you are saying they know your order, but the margin of error is really high. If you are building all of your concept or this, the internet sent down a cable. For a week you won't have a good internet. All of your business will be down. Everything. You understand what I mean? When you do business, you always think, to lower the margin of error as much as you can. The perfect business will have least mistakes possible. Yes, it can look amazing, or whatever, but you need to understand that you need to predict all of these. My opinion.
Who's that good-looking guy there?
Cool.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Everything has a price. But you are, huh? I'll tell you the price of the animal, I'll tell you how much I can. When you do a business, don't get attached to it. If you are attached to your business, open for you a kiosk, a small place, and grow all. If you are in it for passion, just stay there. You understand what I mean? If you are in it for business, there is a price. It's a business side. In 2008, we wanted to sell Choowy Goowy in 2013. When we did the study, that in 2013, we will sell. And this is the trend now. People invest in small companies, develop them, invest to get like Talabat or whatever. We got an offer in 2013 with 3.5 million for Choowy. I want to sell. To me, خلاص, that's خلاص. أكيد الحين أقدر أشتري. Yes. But the problem is not only your decision. My partner convinced me that let's work on it for the next 5 years really hard, sell it for 50. That's why in 2013 we decided that jar GDP should be separated. We are in the process of that. The value of the brand now is much, much higher. That's why we bought in a very good team with us, to make a street sample. But everything has a price. I wanted to sell, my partner said if it was for 6, I would sell. But it was over, you know? They would not make their money at all. The next thing, which is not healthy.
What was that?
We always do it by 5 to 7 monthly. It depends on just when you evaluate what people can, what the brand can be, not only about multiple, because every year when you develop, you have a percentage of improvement in terms of net profit. So we predict, we bought a couple of companies. We bought them very cheap, but we know that it will make much, much more money. So when people want to sell you, you have to take premiums. And we know if you do 1, 2, 3, 4, you make much more money than what you are paying for. So we don't take only the money from them. It depends on the price.
Thank you so much for coming, Essa. We really appreciate your time with us, and I talk on behalf of everyone. We learned so much, and you are very inspirational. And inshallah, we learn from your mistakes.
Please do.
I'm very happy to be here in Serdab Lab. It's one of my favorite places. Who doesn't love a place that makes people better themselves? And today specifically, I got a chance to interview one of my very good friends, Essa Behbehani. And he's already a mentor of mine and someone I look up to and admire. So what better person you can have interview him better than me?
So that was really amazing. Thank you, Essa Behbehani, for allowing us to benefit from your experiences. And the experiences that you have, you know, are vast, from finance and restaurant management up to picking the prices for meals. That was really enjoyable. You guys should really attend the next Startup Grind event. Startup Grind is an event designed to educate, inspire, and connect entrepreneurs and pull them together towards one cause, which is basically pushing forwards the entrepreneurial and business models. And of course, Serdab Lab is hosting this event, and it is the chapter that, and we hold the chapter basically in Serdab Lab. And Serdab Lab is a platform and a hub that is designed to help entrepreneurs push forward their business models via mentorship, via educational programs, and of course via a co-working space and a collaborative community.
Sure, so Serdab Lab is a startup incubator. We help startups grow. We provide mentoring, a co-working space, training, a networking opportunity. Startup Grind is a monthly series where we meet influential or interesting people and ask them about their experiences. I personally benefit a lot from it and hope to see you guys here.
Thank you, Serdab Lab, for providing this opportunity for us to volunteer with you to organize this event.
It's been a pleasure. I love volunteering here at Serdab Lab. We learned a lot, and it was a great experience.
It was a pleasure being with Serdab Lab. I really thank you for this opportunity. I think back in the days, no one even thought of taking care of these type of things to make people learn from businessmen or learn from the people who have experience, learn from failures, learn from their success. So I would like to thank Serdab Lab. It's not only that I've shared my experience, but I learned a lot of things that I didn't know about what people thought of our business. Thank you so much.